Charles Darwin turned our world upside down. His theory of evolution by natural selection is one of the most profound and far-reaching ideas in human history. It's also, alas, one of the most controversial. Science now has the evidence that proves evolution is true. Yet today, incredibly, the opposition to Darwin is more fiercely vocal than ever, denying plain facts in more and more elaborate ways.
You haven't seen it, and I haven't seen it, so please stop calling it science.
If we have gone from slime to human beings, there should be an overwhelming amount of evidence.
You are a teacher of science, and you think that the Earth is less than 10,000 years old.
Yes, I do.
In this program, the increasingly aggressive backlash.
Right now, your destiny is all fucked up, fucking atheist.
The battles that I think really matter.
We can't get into the business of knocking down kids' religions and the religions of families.
Why not, actually?
Why not?
Because... Why not?
And how the first man to understand evolution himself wrestled with religious faith. For Darwin, the problem was close to home. His beloved wife was a devout Christian. Today we have public battles as we confront the ranks of religious fundamentalists eager to attack Darwin's great legacy, which they just don't understand. When I was a young boy, I looked to God to explain life. And then I was introduced to Darwin and evolution by my father.
At first I didn't get it. It didn't seem possible to me that something so simple could explain so much. But then I learned about it a bit more, I thought about it a bit more, and then suddenly the penny dropped. I really got it. This incredibly simple theory really was capable of explaining everything about life, the beauty, the complexity, the diversity. And then I thought, well, if science can explain something so apparently inexplicable as life, who knows what the limits might be on what science could explain more generally, without any recourse to the supernatural. At that moment, I became an atheist, and I've never looked back.
Charles Darwin, too, changed his mind about this biggest of questions. As a young man, during his voyage on the Beagle, Darwin still believed that God had created the world and everything in it. But then he came across more and more evidence that showed that life must have evolved. Fossil ancestors, patterns of anatomical resemblance, startling similarities in embryos, and the power of domestic breeding all showed that life forms had changed over time. Darwin believed there was an entirely natural explanation. All animals vary, and in the competition of nature, some variations are more successful and more likely to reproduce than others, passing their variation on. Here in his study at Down House, Darwin grasped that the religious story of creation ran against the evidence of the natural world. With evolution, God just wasn't part of the picture. But there was a problem for Darwin. His wife Emma was religious, and the trouble began soon after they got married in 1839. Emma wrote him a letter describing her deep faith. But Darwin was no longer convinced there was a God. He agonized over the letter and scribbled on it, "When I am dead, know that many times I have kissed and cried over this." Darwin never criticized religion directly in public. I think he didn't want to hurt his wife's feelings. Instead, he let his science do the talking. He predicted that science would bring about a gradual illumination of minds. Yet, sadly today, it seems harder and harder for people to see the light. Here, in the 21st century, people are retreating from reason, trying to turn back the clock to a world before Darwin.
You see, Genesis chapter 1 says everything that God made was very, and none of you think kill or be killed, survival of the fittest, nature red in tooth and claw is good. Is the world really 6,000 years old? Do you realize up till Noah's day, people lived to be nearly 1,000? You don't die because you get old, you die because you're a sinner. Up till Noah's day, there's no record of rain.
The Australian John Mackay is a celebrity among evangelical Christians. He's a creationist. He believes in the literal truth of the Bible's creation story, and he attacks evolution on the very crudest level.
So I didn't grow up brainwashed with this. It's the result of finishing my university course, listening to students say, if evolution is true, why can't we see it happening? Third year genetics question to the professor. Right.
You take that question seriously, do you?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and the professor, his answer, I took even more seriously when he said, well, it happened so slowly you wouldn't expect to see it happening. And all of a sudden, right. I thought, hang on.
Yeah, that's true.
Good. So in other words, what you don't see happening is not science. It's unobservable. And you were the first person to have it on PBS.
See. You're using the word see as meaning see within one lifetime. If a phenomenon takes millions of years, of course you're not going to see it.
Which means you have a faith position.
It does not.
And you need to admit it.
It means you have to use other evidence than the evidence of one man's eyes. It means you have to look.
Oh, sorry. Darwin was only 1859. That's only 150 years ago almost, right? And you haven't seen it, and I haven't seen it, so please stop calling it science. And call what you're teaching philosophy or atheism, if you're going to really be honest, and my time is up.
That's ridiculous, but anyway, thank you very much.
Thank you.
The refusal to believe in anything you can't see yourself is absurd. Think about it. I never saw Napoleon with my own eyes, but that doesn't mean Napoleon didn't exist. John Mackay can't see a cell or an atom or weather systems on the other side of the world. Does that mean they don't exist? Darwin didn't just trust his own eyes. He checked his theory against evidence gathered through extensive correspondence with naturalists across the world. Mackay, it seems to me, misunderstands science at a deep level. Science is precisely not limited by what we can see with our own eyes in one lifetime. The whole wonderful endeavor of science is to investigate phenomena beyond human experience, from far-off galaxies to microscopic bacteria. Creationism's next best strategy is not flat denial, but to claim there is evidence against evolution and that a genuine debate is yet to be had. This is the creationist's favorite claim in America, where the battle between faith and science really rages. Charles Darwin's struggle with religion was private. Today, the battle has become public. In my lifetime, opposition to evolution has grown, particularly in the United States. Fifty years ago, the Soviet Union launched Sputnik, and the space race began. In response, the Americans made science priority number one. The government poured money into science education. For the first time, evolution was taught in every classroom in America. But the religious fundamentalists hit back.
Tell me, Joe, how does he explain away God?
Well, why don't you come to the science club meeting? Let him tell you.
To defend their Bible against the biologists, they developed creation science, a bizarre fusion of scientific language and religious doctrine that they touted as a real alternative to evolution.
Our eyes are amazing little instruments. But you know, they're only one part of the wondrous body that God has given us.